I'll go, and if indeed Pilgrim consents to come, I'll return with him. But if he is unwilling, then don't expect me, because I won't be coming back either. Go, go," said the little dragon. "He will certainly come." Idiot indeed put away his muckrake and straightened his shirt. He leapt up and mounted the clouds, heading straight toward the east. It so happened that the Tang monk was not yet fated to die. The wind was blowing in the right direction. All Idiot had to do was to stick up his huge ears, and he sped across the eastern ocean as if sails were hoisted on him. The sun was just rising when he dropped from the clouds to find his way in the mountain. As he was walking, he heard someone talking. He took another careful look and found Pilgrim sitting on a huge boulder in a mountain valley. Before him some 1,200 monkeys lined up in ranks, all shouting. "Long live our father great sage!" Eight rules said. "What pleasures! What pleasures! No wonder he doesn't want to be a monk and wants only to come home. Look at all these goodies! Such a huge household, and so many little monkeys to serve him. If old Hog has a large farm like this, I'm not going to be a monk either. Since I've arrived, what shall I do? I suppose I'll have to see him." But Idiot was in truth afraid of Pilgrim, and he dared not show himself openly. Sliding down the grassy meadow, he crawled stealthily into the midst of those 1,000-odd monkeys and began to kowtow, also along with them. He had no idea how high the great sage was sitting and how sharp his vision was. Having seen everything all at once, the Monkey King asked, "Who is that barbarian in the ranks who's bowing in such a confused manner? Where does he come from? Bring him up here." Hardly had he finished speaking when the little monkeys, like a swarm of bees, pushed eight rules to the front and pressed him to the ground. Pilgrim said, "Barbarian, where did you come from? I dare not accept the honor of your questioning me," said eight rules, his head lowered. "I'm no barbarian, I'm an acquaintance," Pilgrim said. "All the monkeys under the command of the great sage here have similar features, not like that lubberly face of yours. You must be some fiendish demon from another region. If so, and if you want to be a subject of mine, you should have first presented us with your name and the particulars of your age and antecedents on a card so that I can take your role when you are assigned to our ranks here. But you haven't even done that, and you dare kneel here to bow to me?" With his head and snout lowered, Eight Rules said, "Oh, for shame! I'll show you my face. I have been a brother of yours now for a few years, and you still claim that you don't recognize me, calling me some kind of barbarian. Raise your head and let me have a look," said Pilgrim with a chuckle. Sticking his snout upward, Idiot said, "Look. Even if you can't recognize me, you can at least recognize this snout of mine." Pilgrim could not refrain from laughing and saying, "Jew Eight Rules." As soon as he heard this, he jumped up, crying, "Yes. Yes. I am Jew Eight Rules." He thought to himself also, "If he recognizes me, then it's easier to speak." Pilgrim said, "Why aren't you accompanying the Tang monk to go fetch scriptures? Why are you here? Could it be that you, too, have offended Master and he banished you also? Do you have any letter of banishment? Let me see it. I didn't offend him," said Eight Rules. "And he didn't give me any letter of banishment. Nor did he dismiss me. If there's no letter and he didn't dismiss you, why are you here?" asked Pilgrim. Eight Rules replied, "Master has been thinking of you. He told me to come and invite you to go back. He didn't think of me, nor did he invite me," said Pilgrim. "He swore to heaven that day and he wrote the letter of banishment himself. How could he think of me and ask me to go back? I definitely will not go back." Eight Rules lied conveniently, saying, "He really did think of you. He really did think of you." "What made him think of me?" asked Pilgrim. Eight Rules said, "As Master was riding on the horse, he called out at one point, 'Disciple.' I didn't hear him, and Sha Monk claimed that he was somewhat deaf. Master at once thought of you, saying that we were worthless, and that only you were smart and alert enough to answer once you were called, to give 10 replies to one question. That's how he thought of you, and he has sent me specially to ask you to go back. Please do so, at least for the sake of his expectation, and for the sake of my having traveled all this distance." When Pilgrim heard these words, he jumped down from the boulder. Taking the hand of 8 rules, he said, "Worthy brother, sorry that you have to travel such a great distance to come. Let's you and I go and have some fun." "Elder brother," said 8 rules, "this place is quite far away, and I fear that master might be kept waiting. I don't want to play." Pilgrim said, "After all, this is your first time here. Take a look at least at my mountain scenery." Idiot dared not persist in his refusal and had to walk away with him. The two of them proceeded hand in hand, while the little monsters followed behind to go up to the highest spot on the Flower Fruit Mountain. Marvelous Mountain. Ever since the great sage's homecoming, it had been completely made new by his labor these few days. You see the mountain. Green as carved jade. Tall like a cloud scraper. All around are tigers crouched and dragons coiled. On 4 sides are frequent calls of apes and cranes. At dawn the clouds blockade the summit. At dusk the sun is poised above the forest. The flowing stream murmurs like tingling girdle jade. The brook sounds drop by drop a psaltery note. Before the mountain are ridges and tall cliffs. Behind the mountain are flowers and dense woods. It touches the jade girl's hair-washing bowl above. It joins a branch of heaven's river down below. This cosmos-formed beauty surpasses Peng Lai. A true cave mansion born of primal breaths. Even master artists find it hard to sketch. Nor can wise immortals depict it all. Like openworks carved finely fantastic rocks. In fantastic colors soar up at the top. The sun moves in a 1,000 purple rays. Auspicious air forms countless strands of red mist. A cave heaven, a blessed place among mankind. A mountain full of fresh blossoms and fresh trees. Delighted by the endless splendor of the scenery, 8 rules said, "Elder brother, what a lovely place. Truly the number one mountain in the whole world." "Worthy brother," said Pilgrim, "think you can pass the time here? Look at the way elder brother talks," chuckled 8 rules. "This precious mountain is a cave heaven, a land of blessing. How could you say, pass the time?" The two of them chatted amiably for a long time before descending from the peak. They met on the way several little monkeys, all holding purple grapes, fragrant pears, bright golden loquats, and dark red strawberries. Kneeling by the road, they cried, "Father Great Sage, please have some breakfast. My brother Ju," said Pilgrim, laughing, "has a huge appetite, and he doesn't take fruits for breakfast. Nonetheless, please don't be offended by such trifles. Use them as snacks and take a few." 8 rules said, "Though I have a huge appetite, I do as the natives do anywhere. Yes, by all means bring them up here. I'll try a few for taste." The two of them ate the fruits, and the sun was fast rising high. Afraid that there might not be enough time to save the Tang monk, Idiot tried to urge his companion to leave, saying, "Elder brother, master is waiting for us. Please hurry and go." "Worthy brother," said Pilgrim, "I'm inviting you to have some fun with me at the Water Curtain Cave." 8 rules at once declined, saying, "I appreciate your kind thoughts, old brother, but master has waited for a long time already. There's really no need for us to enter the cave." "In that case," said Pilgrim, "I dare not detain you. I'll say goodbye right here." "Elder brother," said 8 rules, "aren't you going with me?" Pilgrim said, "Go where? This place of mine is neither governed by heaven nor controlled by earth. I'm completely free here. Why shouldn't I enjoy this? Why should I become a monk again? I will not go. You have to go back by yourself. And please tell the Tang monk that once he has dismissed me, don't ever think of me again. When Idiot heard these words, he dared not press any further, for he was afraid that Pilgrim's temper might flare and he would then receive a couple of strokes from the rod. He had no alternative but to take leave meekly and find his way back. When Pilgrim saw him leave, he ordered two agile little monkeys to follow him and to find out what he was going to say. Indeed, when that idiot descended the mountain, he did not cover more than 3 or 4 miles before he turned around and pointed his finger at the direction of Pilgrim. "You ape!" he cried. "You don't want to be a priest. You choose to be a monster instead. What an ape! I came here with good intentions to ask him to go back, but he refused. All right. If you don't want to go, you don't have to." He took a few steps and began his castigations again. The two little monkeys ran back to report. "Father Great Sage, that Zhu 8 rules is rather sneaky. He's ranting at you as he walks away." Pilgrim grew angry and shouted, "Seize him." All the little monkeys rushed after 8 rules and pushed him to the ground. Clutching at his mane and tugging at his ears, pulling his tail and grabbing his hair, they hauled him bodily back to the cave. We do not know how he will be treated or what will happen to him. Let's listen to the explanation in the next chapter.